This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Good evening. Thanks for coming. My name is Matt Cooperberg. I'm a urologist, urologic oncologist at the Cancer Center here at UCSF. And I also work at the San Francisco VA. I also have an appointment in the Department of Epidemiology and Biostatistics. And what I'm going to talk about today is some of the progress that we're seeing both at the national level and some of the work that we're doing here in trying to make more personalized decisions for men diagnosed with prostate cancer, focusing on early stage disease. You know, the title in the brochure was early prostate cancer. Really what we're focusing on is localized disease, or at least clinically localized disease, prostate cancer, which, as far as we can tell, is confined to the prostate itself. So you may know from the 40,000-foot view, prostate cancer remains by far the most common cancer diagnosed among men in the United States. The estimate this year is that nearly 250,000 men will be diagnosed with the disease, and nearly 30,000 men will die of it. And that's, of course, a big number. It's the second biggest cause of cancer mortality among men in this country, with the exception of lung cancer. And yet, 30,000 is much smaller than 230,000. And you can't quite compare those numbers as a simple ratio like that, but the fact of the matter is that most men with prostate cancer die of other causes, typically cardiac disease, just like men that don't have prostate cancer, because that's what kills most men in America. And ultimately, our challenge is trying to figure out which men diagnosed with the disease are actually at risk of dying of it. Just a brief overview, in case you're not familiar with what the prostate is, where it is. It's a reproductive gland. Its job is to make some of the fluid that surrounds sperm at time of ejaculation, and so it's a reproductive organ. It sits here. This is sort of a middle view, a side view, looking at the bladder here. The prostate comes off the middle of the bladder. The urethra, which is the tube you pee through, comes right through the prostate, out the penis this way. The rectum is right back here. These are the seminal vesicles, which are the glands that also make some of the fluid that surround sperm. And this is just another view of the same thing. So again, bladder, prostate, urethra. And the challenge with treating prostate cancer, with managing prostate cancer, is all about the tight, confined neighborhood in which it lives. And anything we do to the prostate has the risk of damaging or at least, you know, irritating some of these organs, the bladder, the rectum, and the urethra. Now, a lot of the data that I'm going to show you tonight come from a registry called CAPTURE, which we have run here out of UCSF since 1995. This tracks men with prostate cancer diagnosed all across the country, mostly community-based practices. There are 45 sites that have ever participated in the registry. This is where they are across the country, so representing, I think, about 26 states. And again, mostly these are community-based, sort of real-world practices. There's about 15,000 men that have participated, and it's one of the best sources of really high quality, granular data that we have to really try to sort out what goes on at the national level in prostate cancer. And this is one of the looks that I want to show you of the way the disease has changed over time with PSA screening. So you probably know around the early 1990s, we got this test called PSA, which is prostate specific antigen. It's a blood test. Remember, it's prostate-specific. It's not prostate cancer-specific. So there are other things that can happen to the prostate, like enlargement as you get older or infection. There's other things that can make the PSA go up, but it's really sort of most best known or most notorious, depending on your perspective, for its use as a screening test, a screening tool for prostate cancer. And around the early 1990s, this test started getting adopted in primary care in the United States. And what we've seen is a real shift in the look of prostate cancer nationally at the time of diagnosis. So this is a look at men in CAPTURE. And if you look at men who have low risk, and I'll talk a little bit later exactly what we mean by low risk, high risk, et cetera. But before the PSA era really started, only about a quarter of men who were diagnosed with prostate cancer had what looked like low risk disease. Over a third had high risk disease, and a quarter had advanced disease at time of diagnosis, meaning the cancer was already out It was into the lymph nodes, it was into the bones, it was beyond a state that we would typically think of as curable. Now, as time has gone on and we've screened more and more, we've really shifted what the face of prostate cancer looks like. It is much more common now to be diagnosed with a low-risk prostate cancer or intermediate. The proportion of men with high-risk disease is now down to 2%. Now, the catch here is, of course, we're diagnosing a lot more cancers in these more recent years than we were in the pre-PSA era. But the fact of the matter is what it means to have prostate cancer, what it means to get that diagnosis, is very different today than it was in the pre-PSA era. And just a side comment, we're increasingly aware of prostate cancer as a global disease. This is certainly not just a problem in the US or in the West. If you look across the world, we see real profound variation in the incidence, that's how often we see the cancer, and in the mortality, which is how often it is lethal. And there's actually not very good correlation between these two figures. So there are some countries that screen very intensely, find a lot of prostate cancer, and have relatively low mortality. And that's actually the case here. This is North America here. There are other countries like Australia that have an even higher incidence and have higher mortality. And there's other regions of the world, particularly those with a strong African genetic heritage, the Caribbean and West Africa in particular, that don't screen and yet have a high incidence of prostate cancer and a very high burden of lethal disease. And these are parts of the world where you would think prostate cancer would be less of an issue because men are more likely to die of infectious disease or trauma or other issues early in life, and yet prostate cancer is causing a significant mortality burden to men relatively early in life in these parts of the world. And we can see hints of that even here locally, because the question when you look at data like this is why, okay? And we know the answer is it's multifactorial. The question is, you know, how much of it can you attribute to genetics? How much of it can you attribute to, you know, individual genetics versus broad patterns you can try to look at a you know, racial or regional level? How much of it is dietary factors? How much is other environmental factors? How much of it is stress of stress of poverty, stress of certain aspects of life? If you look at our experience here, so this is a look at risk distribution in the CAPTCHA registry that I mentioned. So again, this is sort of a cross-section of community experience in the United States. What we see is most men that we diagnose with prostate cancer have relatively low risk disease. I'll tell you about the CAPTCHA score a little later, but this is a 0 to 10 risk stratification system. 0 to 2 we think of as low risk disease. And again, this is about half of all prostate cancers. Some have intermediate risk. Very few men who are diagnosed today have high risk disease, and only about 4% have advanced disease. Again, prostate cancer that's already out of the gland at the time of diagnosis. If you look at the county hospital population here, this is SF General just across town here, you see a very different pattern. And these men are about the same age at time of diagnosis, so this is not just the issue that they don't have access to healthcare, and it's not just a question of African-American men, because we actually see this across all different race groups in the county population. You can still see that, you know, the most common pattern is relatively low risk, but you see a much higher burden of intermediate and high risk disease and a threefold higher burden of advanced disease at the time of diagnosis in this population. Again, same city, racially diverse patient population, but a much higher burden of disease. And we think that there is, you know, again, it's multifactorial. How much of this is, you know, access to, you know, poor access to good nutrition, poor access to exercise, and how much of it is things like stress of poverty and stress of, you know, the what's referred to as allostatic stress. In other words, uncontrollable stress. You know, there's you know, we have a stressful job, but, you know, for most of us, if we quit today, we would not worry about the roof over our heads, but not knowing where your next meal is coming from for years on end is probably bad for you in ways that we don't quite understand, but that do bear on risk of cancer. So pulling back now to the overall view of what's going on in the United States, this is looking at prostate cancer mortality over the years here. These data really stretch back to the 1930s. And you can see over time, prostate cancer mortality really has been relatively stable. It actually drifted up steadily as the population got older and older. Men are less likely to die of other cancers and things throughout the 50s and 60s, onset of refrigeration, et cetera. And you see a spike up here in the early 1990s. And since that time, this was around when PSA was introduced. And since that time, prostate cancer mortality has been plunging. It has fallen about 50% since the dawn of the PSA era. Now, this is not the percentage of guys with prostate cancer that die of it. This is the population mortality rate. So for every 100,000 men, age adjusted, how many men die of prostate cancer? This is a huge victory at the epidemiologic level. The only other cancer where you see this steep of a decline is lung cancer. We know that that's mostly from smoking cessation. So we see this prostate cancer decline. There's no environmental factor that explains this that we know of. This is a time when men are living longer, dying less often of cardiac disease early in life, so they should be more at risk of dying of prostate cancer, because most men don't die of this disease until they get into their 70s and 80s. The upshot is at least a third of this is probably explainable by early detection, by PSA, another third by improvements in treatment, and about a third we don't know. Some of it might actually be smoking rates and other changes in diet and environment, et cetera. But, you know, there's no question that this is good news. Again, nearly a 50% drop in mortality since the early 1990s. So how could this possibly have happened? Okay, this, which was last year, 2 years ago, the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force, which is the federal body tasked by the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, which is ARC, their mission is to make recommendations on preventive medicine of all stripes. And their original mission was really just to look at things like vaccination strategies for children. Then they got into things like, you know, blood pressure screening and cholesterol management, all that sort of thing. And more recently have sort of gotten into the area of cancer screening. There's not an oncologist, there's not a surgeon, there's not any sort of content expert on the panel membership. And that's supposed to be by design. And I'll tell you a little more about some of the problems from this methodology. But at the end of the day, they came out 2 years ago and said, do not screen for prostate cancer, period. And it's very important to stress that what they said is do not screen. They didn't say screen African-American men, screen men with family history, screen men with long life expectancy. They said don't screen on the basis that, in their opinion, their interpretation of the evidence, that the risks of screening outweigh the benefits. We'll get into that data a little bit later. But the question is, how could that have possibly happened in the background of what is, again, I think, a real victory at the public health level? Well, this is partly, largely, our fault. And when I say our, I'm speaking very broadly. It's urology, primary care, radiation oncology, in that we've really failed to recognize, or at least we've failed to apply in practice, what we know is an extremely heterogeneous disease. Okay, we use the word cancer for lots of things in life. And at one end, you've got pancreatic cancer, lung cancer, things where, you know, this really is imminently life-threatening. You need to take immediate action. This is really a very dire diagnosis. Prostate cancer lives at the other end of the spectrum. Most men with prostate cancer are not facing, you know, even potentially dying of it for 10, 20 years or more from the time of diagnosis. And even within prostate cancer, you've got this extreme variation in its prognosis and how aggressive it is. So this is a cartoon from an article written a couple years ago, which is just about cancer screening in general. And this could be PSA for prostate cancer, it could be mammography for breast cancer, colonoscopy, what have you. And the idea is you can screen on a given interval. This is every year, every 10 years, whatever it is. And the cancer can progress from a microscopic state to an organ-confined one, where you can see or feel a tumor, but it's only in the organ, to one which is spread regionally, to one which is metastatic. And the idea is if you get to the top of the chart here, you've died of the cancer. And if you get to the right side, you've died of something else. And we know that even with aggressive prostate cancer screening, we don't find most of the prostate cancers. If you live long enough as a man in America, you are very likely to get a couple of cancer cells somewhere in the prostate. Men who die of heart attacks in their 70s, the vast majority have a couple of cancer cells in the prostate if we do an autopsy and look hard enough. In most cases, these were completely clinically insignificant. The man never would have had any idea he had these if he hadn't done the autopsy. Now, with screening, we find a lot that are not much more aggressive than that. They're still in this organ-confined state, and had we not found them, they never would have caused any symptoms or any threat to life over the entire course of the man's life until he died of something else. And this is what we refer to as overdiagnosis. And this is a big, big problem in cancer, not just PSA for prostate cancer. You'll hear the same debates about mammography for breast cancer. It applies to cholesterol checks as well. Anytime you do any kind of screening for preventive health reasons, you will have this problem of overdiagnosis, finding things that did not have to be found. We see them with small kidney masses as well, even sometimes small bladder tumors. Now, these are the ones that we're looking for. Okay? There are prostate cancers that are more aggressive that we can find early while they're still confined to the prostate. We can cure them. Here it's actually a cure. And this is a cancer whose fate it was to cause mortality had we not found it. Okay, 5-10 years down the road, this would have become lethal, or at least would have been past the point of potential cure. But if we find it early enough, we can intervene and we can save this life. And then there are the ones which unfortunately just rise out of nowhere very quickly. These are fortunately very rare. They're called interval tumors sometimes. This is somebody whose PSA is 1, then it's 1.2, then it's 1.3, then it's 15. And you know, you're never going to win here with any sort of screening program. This is the same reason we can't screen for pancreatic cancer. They kind of pop up out of nowhere, and they're out of the box and spread to the other parts of the body very, very quickly. And again, fortunately, they are rare. It's a very atypical prostate cancer that behaves like this. The struggle is really between the rabbits and the turtles, and you know, not crushing too much of the turtle population in the course of chasing the rabbits. And we haven't done a very good job of that. We haven't done a very good job sparing the turtles. Which gets into the one of the other challenges here, which is we've got dozens of ways to skin this cat. There's probably too many treatment options in many cases, which tends to contribute to confusion. The primary treatment options, we know, there's active surveillance, which means carefully following the tumor over time. I'll talk a little bit later about the differences between surveillance and the older concept of watchful waiting. We can take out the prostate and do what's called a radical prostatectomy. We can do radiation either with external beam treatment or with brachytherapy, which means treating it from the inside out. Or for more advanced disease, there's hormonal therapy and chemotherapy and a whole host of novel treatments, which I think Dr. Ryan was here a couple weeks ago talking about. But it's actually a lot more complicated than this. You know, what active surveillance means has really been evolving over the last few years. Surgery can now be done open, transperineally, laparoscopically, robotically. There are more flavors of external beam radiation than you can ever keep track of. Brachytherapy, there's seeds, there's catheters, there's different types of seeds. It gets more and more confusing for the newly diagnosed person trying to make sense of the diagnosis and the treatment options. Then there's cryotherapy. We're interested in doing focal therapy, meaning just treating the tumor when possible. And then, of course, there's advertisements out there for all kinds of other things which really have very, very poor data behind them, like HIFU. There's all sorts of focal therapy or ablative treatments out there with very poor follow-up. So, we haven't done a great job implementing screening, either in terms of who gets screened or who gets treated. These are data from the VA system in 2006, looking at screening practices. So we know that the best way to use PSA testing is to test early in life, get a baseline around age 40, 45, or 50. And if the PSA is low at that time, you really don't need to check every year. But that's the best time to check because there's less enlargement of the prostate, there are fewer confounding factors, fewer other reasons for the PSA to be false positively elevated. So the best time is to check early. But if you actually look at the practice pattern out there in primary care, the most common time to check a PSA is age 67. And it's really, and continues to spike up into the 70s. So this is a look at men in the VA system. In their early 70s, late 70s, early 80s, late 80s, stratified by their health. So this is what we call the Charlson comorbidity score, and it's just kind of a checklist of other health conditions, heart disease, stroke, that sort of thing. So if you look at men in their 70s, about two-thirds of them got a PSA check in this 1 year, and those in perfect health with no comorbidities were a little bit more likely to get a PSA test than those with four or more comorbidities. Now, as you get into men over 85, now even those of us who are pretty strong advocates for screening would typically say the only 85-year-old who should get screened is the one who brings both of his parents to the exam. Because again, we're talking about 10, 15, 20 years down the road here when you draw a PSA test. There is no debate, there's no argument from anybody anywhere that the patient in the clinical exam room with a less than 10-year life expectancy does not need a PSA check and should never think about the word prostate for the rest of his life in the vast majority of cases. So you have an 85-year-old man with four comorbidities, 35% of these guys got a PSA check. Now, that's not because the doctor sat down and had a detailed conversation with them about the pros and cons of screening, and they reached a mutual shared decision to do the test. They just kind of check the box on the Chem 70 every time the patient rolls through because that's what they do. And unfortunately, too much of screening is done that way. The primary care doc either believes in it or they don't, and either everybody gets it or nobody gets it. And that's not the right way to screen. And then the flip side is we actually do a terrible job as a treating community, the urology community nationally and the radiation oncology community, of targeting the treatments appropriately to the men who are most likely to benefit. So these are data, again, from CAPTURE. So green bars here are prostatectomy, surgery. The pale blue is cryotherapy, which is pretty uncommonly done. That's freezing the prostate. Orange and red are forms of radiation therapy, brachy or external beam treatment. Blue is hormonal therapy alone, so just giving medication to suppress the cancer. This is not curative. It will put it in check for a number of years, but it's not curative. And then up here is watchful waiting and active surveillance. And these bars are sorted from low risk to high risk. And what you can see is that men with low risk disease very commonly get surgery. As we see higher and higher risk disease, surgery becomes less and less commonly used. The green bars get smaller and smaller. Likelihood of getting radiation is really pretty constant across the entire spectrum of risk. We see a little more external beam, a little less brachytherapy, but this really is not particularly sensitive to the risk of disease. And I'm talking about the risk that the cancer will actually progress, okay, the risk that this might actually be a lethal cancer. We see very little use of active surveillance for watchful waiting. This is data up through 2007 at this point, and that, of course, gets less as the disease risk goes up. And then this is the other problem. So we see a lot of over-treatment here. Okay, so low-risk disease, many of these men, probably most of these men, should be getting active surveillance or some conservative management strategy. It's only 8%. But the other problem is there's under-treatment. So men with high-risk disease, who are the ones who most need an aggressive multimodal approach, are those who are actually most likely to just get put on hormonal therapy and never offered a chance at cure. Now, these are all men with what looks like organ-confined disease. This does not include people who already have metastatic disease. If you've got disease in the bones at the time of diagnosis, that 2% I showed you before, that's men who should be on just hormonal therapy in most cases. But these are men with what looks like organ-confined disease. There's really no data to support hormonal therapy as monotherapy, as solo treatment. Now, part of the issue is that this turns out to be a bit of an age bias in practice. So one of the things in a screened population like ours in the US is that the older you are at the time of diagnosis, the more likely you are to have a high-risk tumor. And this makes sense. It's a screened population. If you got screened a lot in your 50s and 60s, it's pretty likely that the cancer will be picked up early. Whereas if you're not being diagnosed until your 70s or 80s, it's probably because you have not been screened much in life, so the cancer's had more time to grow. So you're more likely to have a high-risk tumor at age 80. It's about a third of them, as opposed to, you know, less than 6% of men in their early 50s have high-risk disease at the time of diagnosis. So high-risk prostate cancer is frequently a disease of older men, and there's an age bias in how we treat them. So this is the same data that I showed you before, but this is stratified now by age and by risk. Okay, so each set of three columns here is low, intermediate, high-risk disease. Low, intermediate, high, by age. So men under 55, late 50s, early 60s, etc. So you see, again, young men tend to get surgery regardless of risk. Young men with high-risk disease do not get surgery probably as often as they should. You know, 18% of these men, despite being young in their 50s with a bad tumor, only got hormonal therapy. But when you look at men over 75, you see the twin problems, again, of over and under treatment. So older men with low-risk disease, these are men who are almost certain to die of a heart attack a decade before the prostate will ever be a problem. Only a quarter of these men got active surveillance for watchful waiting. And conversely, 60% of older men with high-risk disease only got hormonal therapy. Now, we know that men diagnosed even in their 80s with high-risk prostate cancer, without local treatment, 25% of them die of prostate cancer within 10 years. And you know, the other point that we don't talk about that often here is that this is not the way you would choose to go off the menu of possible options. Dying of prostate cancer tends to be slow, it tends to be painful, and it's you know, there are aspects to it beyond just avoiding a death. One of the leading lights in prostate cancer research, Ian Thompson, University of Texas, gave a talk last year at a national meeting, and his father had just died of prostate cancer at 92, and he made the comment that it's no less an unacceptable death at 92 than it would have been at 62. So this idea of undertreating older men who have high-risk prostate cancer really is a significant part of the problem. It's less common. You know, this is a bigger problem at the kind of 40,000-foot view. Again, you know, low-risk prostate cancer is more common than high-risk prostate cancer, but under-treating high-risk disease is the flip side to the problem just as much as over-treating low-risk disease. Now, the other problem is that we are all over the map. Okay, these are actually old data. This is the investigators at Dartmouth since the early 1980s have been interested in this issue of variations in care. The story is that there were two neighboring counties in New Hampshire with exactly the same population that could trace their roots back to the Mayflower, you know, 600 years, you know, 300 years earlier, same families, same parents, same kids, and they looked at the rates of tonsillectomy in these two counties, and it was three or four-fold variation from one county to the next. Exactly the same population, same viruses circulating, same diet, same environment. The only factor that could explain the three-fold variation was one surgeon happened to live in one county and tended to like doing tonsillectomies, and the next county had a different surgeon who didn't like doing tonsillectomies. And that kind of led to this whole issue of examining variations in healthcare utilization. And it's a big problem. You read about this in the papers all the time. So they took the 10 most common surgical procedures in the US in the mid-1990s in Medicare and just plotted the standard deviation. In other words, if you think about the mean, you know, 1.0 being the average rate, the average use of a procedure, the higher the number here, up or down, is the more variation you have away from that mean at the county level all across the United States. So if everything's kind of clustered around 1 here means there's not much spread. And over here at the left is hip fracture repair. You break your hip, we should probably fix it. There's not much discussion about that. And you can see here, accordingly, the dots are all pretty much clustered around the median because the indication is pretty consistent. As you go over to the right, you have things like colectomy for colon cancer, cardiac bypass. There's a little bit more variation. Maybe there's more stenting done in one county than the next. You get into back surgery where the data are not nearly as good and there's a lot more variation. This is lower extremity bypass, and way over here on the right is radical prostatectomy, okay, with the greatest spread of any of the common surgical procedures. 3 standard deviations, which is about a 96% variation from top to bottom in terms of likelihood of getting a prostatectomy, just depending on where you live. And we've shown the same thing in CAPTURE. These are the individual, I told you, CAPTURE has these 40 sites across the US. These are the sites in CAPTURE with at least 30 patients. And this is just looking at the practice patterns at the individual practices. So just depending on which urology practice you happen to show up at, your likelihood of getting a prostatectomy ranges from about 16% to 96%. Likelihood of active surveillance ranges from 0 to about 21%. You know, you pick a treatment and you can find these fairly extreme variations. Now, you could say that some of the practices are seeing higher risk patients than others. You know, maybe they're seeing lower risk patients than others. That may well be true, which is why these bars are sorted by the mean risk per site. So the bars over here are those practices seeing the lowest risk patients on average. These are the practices seeing the highest risk patients on average. I've shown this graph to a lot of statisticians. Nobody has yet shown me any sort of pattern to explain this. This is just buckshot. This is random variation. Because we don't have guidelines saying you should get surgery, you should get radiation, people sort of do what they're comfortable doing, what they're good at, what they get paid for. There's all these non-clinical factors that drive treatment decision making, and it's a big problem. And it's a particular problem when it comes to prostate cancer. Now, we just very recently have looked at the most updated data in CAPTURE going up to 2013, and there is a glimmer of hope here in that if you look at low-risk disease, this is now sorted over time. The numbers are a little crowded here, but this is 1993 to 94, 95 to 99, et cetera. You know, this is what I showed you before, less than 8% of men with low-risk disease getting active surveillance for watchful waiting. Well, this is now shot up to 26%, and I think we're finally recognizing as a specialty that we need to be doing more surveillance, less treatment for low-risk prostate cancer in particular. We're slow on the uptake here. Hopefully it's not too late, and frankly, 25% is still far too low, but we're at least starting to see signs of movement in the right direction, really just in the last couple of years. So is the task force right? You know, maybe we're doing a terrible job, and maybe PSA doesn't actually save any lives. I mean, that's what they say in their statement, is that PSA screening saves 0 to 1 life at 8 to 10 years, and the risk of dying of prostate cancer after surgery is 1 in 1,000, or 5 in 1,000. You know, are they right? So what are they drawing from? You know, you really have to go, well, one of the major lessons in this whole story is you cannot go to the New York Times to get your healthcare information when it comes to a complicated topic like this. And this is a really important point, unfortunately, because these are really complicated questions and very complicated data. And I hate to say it, but the task force does not understand them. And I've met a number of them. They're very well-intentioned epidemiologists. They do not understand the literature in this problem when it comes to prostate cancer. So what do we have to go on? We've got 2 really big randomized trials, and that's always what we want in medicine, okay? It's a randomized trial of something versus something else. It's the only way, we think, to really sort of get at the root of a question. Because if I just say, okay, I'm going to take the men who got PSA screened and the men who didn't get PSA screened and just follow them, well, maybe there's something different about the men who got screened. Maybe they're healthier, maybe they have more money, they're better educated, they don't have other health conditions. They may be different in a lot of ways that we might not even be able to identify from the men who chose not to get screened. Okay, so the only way to really answer the question, we think, is to randomize them, all right, and say we're going to take a big cohort of men, you get a PSA test, you don't. Okay, flip a coin and go on and see what happens to these men. So we did this, so there's 2 big studies that try to do this, one in the United States, one in Europe, and you'll hear about the American trial and the European trial when you read the Times coverage of this and when you read the task force statement. So the American trial was the P section of the PLCO trial, which is the prostate, lung, colon, and ovarian cancer screening trial. It's a very big study. Started in the early 1990s. I'll tell you in a second what exactly it did, but the upshot and sort of the soundbite that the New York Times quoted when the paper came out in March of 2009 came from the conclusion of the abstract in the New England Journal of Medicine, a very prominent journal, that with 7 to 10 years follow-up, the rate of death of prostate cancer in the screening group did not differ from the control group. Okay, so the screening and the no screening groups, there was no improvement in mortality, therefore they found no benefit to screening. Okay? The devil is 100% in the details of what this study tried to do and what it, in fact, was able to do. So this is a very big effort. You know, this was funded by the NIH, you know, eight-figure budget here. They had almost 77,000 men at six centers in the U.S. in their late 50s to early 70s who were randomly assigned to annual PSA testing for 6 years, so PSA once a year for 6 years, versus usual care at 10 centers, 1993 to 2001. And this first bullet point here honestly sums up the entire problem from the PLCO, because what was usual care in the United States from 1993 to 2001? This is exactly when PSA was hitting everybody's radar. It's when primary care doctors were excited about it. Everybody was running out and getting a PSA test. So usual care in the United States in the 1990s included an extremely high penetrance of PSA testing. So it turns out that the percentage of men in the so-called control group who never got a PSA test was 21%. Okay, 79% of the men, the vast majority of men who weren't supposed to get a PSA test did, either before the study started or during the study period. They got randomized to no screening, but you know, their neighbor just got prostate cancer, their brother just got prostate cancer. They said, you know, the heck with the study, please check my PSA. And this happened constantly throughout the entire study period. Not only that, of course, PSA is only a screening test. If you have a high PSA, the way to figure out if there's actually prostate cancer in there is to do a prostate biopsy. Well, only 30 to 40% of the men who actually had a high PSA followed up and got a biopsy done. So at the end of the day, there was virtually no difference whatsoever between the two arms of the study, despite this being a very well-planned, very expensive, and well-thought-out trial. It was not well-executed, and there was no difference between these two arms, between the screening arm and the control group in the PLCO. We actually wrote a letter to the editor when this paper first came out, pointing this out, that it's not a study of screening versus no screening. What this is a study of annual screening every 6 years versus ad hoc whenever you happen to show up to your primary care doctor's office screening. And in fact, that's probably the case. You don't have to get screened every year. And the new AUA guideline says very clearly you do not need to get screened every year. Every 2 years, every 4 years is probably fine, maybe even less frequently than that. But to say that the PLCO is showing evidence that there is no benefit for screening is simply false. And the investigators of the PLCO themselves, in an update to the trial in 2012, you know, again, reported no benefit, but their conclusion this time was much more circumspect. It's kind of small type, but they say at 13 years of follow-up now, which again is just scratching the surface of sufficient follow-up, at 13 years there's no evidence of a mortality benefit for organized annual screening in the PLCO trial compared with opportunistic screening, which forms part of usual care. Okay, so again, what this trial showed is that annual screening is not better than whenever you happen to get a PSA test screening. That is a true statement. To interpret this trial as showing that there is evidence that PSA screening is not effective is simply false. That's not a controversial point. It's not a point that you can argue with. It's simply a truth. The task force chooses to ignore that truth, but it's really not a controversial point. So what about the European trial? So the European trial is even bigger. This is the European randomized study of screening for prostate cancer. An even bigger study. It was originally published on the same day as the PLCO in 2009. And this was an even bigger effort. 182,000 men at seven European centers. This was seven countries that were organizing these trials around the same time and decided to join forces. So there were some differences in the protocols from country to country. Some used every 2 years as screening intervals. Some used every 4 years. The important thing to know, though, is that in Europe, when the study was being conducted, there was not much PSA screening going on in the general population, unlike the United States. So they had much more of a control group than we did here. What they found was about a 21% reduction in the risk of dying of prostate cancer with the screening group compared to the control group. And if you go into the later years of follow-up, that goes up to about 38%. And if you adjust for non-compliance and non-adherence, in other words, some men that weren't supposed to get screened did, and some men that were supposed to get a PSA didn't, if you adjust for those factors, then the risk reduction goes up to about 30%. And this is just a look. These are the survival curves here. As time goes on, up to 14 years after the screen, this is the likelihood of actually dying of prostate cancer. And it's a little bit more likely in the control group compared to the screening group. And these curves are continuing to spread out as time goes on. Because again, for a man who's 50 at year zero, well, 14 years later, he's 64. His horizon is going to stretch another 20, 30 years off to the right here. So the other problem with the task force is the idea of making a recommendation based on an outcome at 8 to 10 years is completely and utterly meaningless. Okay, if you have an 8 to 10 year horizon, don't get a PSA test. Not controversial, very easy. The relevant time frame here is 20, 30 years. And it's very hard to do a study and follow it on for that much time. It's very expensive, very difficult to keep track of the men. The final one worth mentioning here is the Göteborg study. This is a city in Sweden that randomized its entire population without their consent, as it happens. Half the men in the city got a letter saying, congratulations, you've been randomized to prostate cancer screening. The other half were not informed. And then one of the beauty, you know, wonderful things about living in Sweden is they have a truly national cancer registry going back to the, I think, to the 50s. So they can track every cancer in the country, and people don't really move very often. So they really had this you know, very controlled, confined cohort to follow. And they started screening men younger than either PLCO or ERSPC. Their average age was 56. They used every 2 years. They referred for biopsy when the PSA was 2.5, which is relatively low. And importantly, they didn't treat everybody. So 44% of the men that they found with prostate cancer were put on active surveillance. And this was prescient. I mean, this was in the 1990s, early 2000s. This was long before surveillance was on anybody's radar here. And this is what they found. Relative risk of 56, meaning there's a 44% reduction in the risk of mortality when you do screening right, okay, which is basically what this study is an example of. Half of these patients wound up in the ERSPC. The older half, the men who were over 55 at time of screening, were included in the ERSPC. And for that reason, this is sometimes described as a subset analysis of the ERSPC. It's not true. This study was planned before the ERSPC. It was always intended to be published independently. And I believe it's actually the younger half of the cohort which really drive this survival benefit. You can see these curves really splitting quite profoundly as time goes on. And you hear about the numbers needed to screen, numbers needed to treat. Because this was when the New York Times picked up on these two studies in 2009, the two sound bites were the American study shows no benefit, the European trial shows a benefit. But what they initially reported was that you had to screen over 1,000 men, and you had to treat 48 to save one life. Well, that was true, but that was to save one life within 8 to 10 years, which, again, is not what we care about when we're talking about prostate cancer. We care about 20 to 30 years. And if you do it right and you have longer follow-up, up to 13, 14 years, the number needed to treat here falls to 12, which starts to compare much better to any other screening intervention. And, in fact, if you take the ERSPC data and project them forward, this is from a group of investigators called CISNET, who are funded by the NIH. These are statisticians. They're not oncologists. They're not clinicians. They've got no skin in the game. They'll never make a penny more or less if we screen or don't screen. Their entire careers are dedicated to just understanding the screening data at a statistical level, mathematical modeling. And they do this better than anybody. And if you want final proof as to whether the task force was interested in finding the truth, the CISNET investigators approached them and said, you know, we understand you're looking at this question again, can we help? And the task force said, no, we got this, because we've spent a month reading a couple papers. We know this better than you do. So CISNET took the ERSPC data and projected them forward. And if you look at the ERSPC report, the published paper, they had 0.7 lives saved per 1,000 men, which is not a big number. And the overdiagnosis rate was high. So they were finding a lot of prostate cancer that did not need to be found in order to potentially save one life. And that's where this 48 number comes from that the New York Times picked up on. It's just the ratio of 34 divided by 0.7. Okay? Now, if you project forward over the man's life, though, you'll find even a few more overdiagnoses if you continue to screen every 2 to 4 years. So this number will go up to 42, but the lives saved now goes up to 6. Now, this is still not a big number, okay? 6 out of 1,000. Most men with prostate cancer still die of cardiac disease. Most men in the world don't die of prostate cancer. Most die of cardiac disease. So there's a limit to how many lives you're going to save at the overall population level, looking at the forest through the trees, no matter how well you screen. But if you look at the number needed to treat here, you're down to 7. And this compares favorably to anything else we do in preventative health. Mammography, cholesterol screening, getting your blood pressure checked, taking a statin. You know, nothing that we do for preventive purposes does much better than number needed to treat of 7. So a guideline, like the task force, referring to benefits at 8 to 10 years of follow-up is completely and utterly without meaning. That's a very important point. We really need to take very much the long view. We care about what happens 10, 20, 30, 40 years down the road if you're talking about a 50-year-old man. A final point I want to make on screening comes from an editorial written by a guy named Alan Detsky in JAMA a couple years ago. So Dr. Detsky was one of the original decision analysis gurus, and he built this decision model, a mathematical model, looking at the benefits of PSA screening ages before anybody else was doing this. 1994, he wrote a paper in JAMA when PSA was just hitting everybody's radar, and he ran this decision model and basically concluded that PSA was a lousy test and we shouldn't be doing it. And he was one of the first people to really be saying that publicly. Well, time went on. Dr. Detsky got a little bit older, and lo and behold, decided to get a PSA checked when he turned 60. And he wrote this nice sort of opinion piece about going out and tracking down one of his former trainees, who was now a urologist, and had a whole conversation with him and decided to go out and get a PSA test. And his PSA was low. It was 0.8 or something. And he wrote this really nice opinion piece about the fact that we always forget about the benefit of knowing that you don't have to worry about prostate cancer. Okay, most men in America, you turn on the news, you pick up a paper, are aware of this problem. Everybody knows somebody that's had it. And there is a real value in reassurance, because most people that get a PSA check have a low value and can basically take this off your list of worries in life. And that's the majority of men. Okay, most men have a low value. We talk endlessly about the harms of a false positive elevated PSA and all the anxiety that that causes, et cetera. But all the people in sort of the anti-camp always assume that the perfect state is, the naive, you don't know either way, don't even ask me about my prostate, that's the best, that's the best place to be, and you can only get worse from there. And it's just not true. Knowing that you don't have prostate cancer is a better state than not knowing either way, and that's the majority of men that get a PSA test. Now, I'm not in any way meaning to downplay the problems of overtreatment and the problems of side effects associated with treatment, because that's sort of the subtext that has driven the task force and has driven a lot of this pendulum swinging against screening. And the fact of the matter is we need to do a much better job as a profession in breaking this automatic assumption that you're diagnosed with cancer, we've got to treat the cancer. And a lot of this has to do with, it's the C word. How can you not treat cancer? And that gets back to what I said earlier. We use that word for a lot of things in life. And this cancer, especially low-risk prostate cancer, has nothing at all to do with pancreatic, lung, these more aggressive ones. And the fact is we need to do a much better job sorting treatments appropriately for men most likely to benefit. The majority of men with low-risk prostate cancer should be on active surveillance, which means we follow the PSA carefully, we do repeat biopsies, we follow it with every intent of treating for cure if we see the cancer starting to progress. And in the large majority of cases, we expect we will be able to see that signal before it's too late, before the first cells escape. For men with slightly higher risk disease, they will do better with local, they'll do well with local therapy, with surgery, radiation, et cetera. Men who've got aggressive prostate cancer probably should be treated much more often than they are with multimodal treatment. If you think about it, what do we do with breast cancer, rectal cancer, gastric cancer? Most aggressive cancers, the answer is all the above. You get surgery, radiation therapy, and chemotherapy. That is the standard pathway. And yet, in prostate cancer, we're still debating about surgery versus radiation. Why? Because most of the debate focuses on low-risk disease, where it's really all about the side effects. When it comes to actually curing the cancer, which is what matters for high-risk prostate cancer, we're sort of 10 years behind everybody else in terms of figuring out the best strategy. Now, there's lots of different ways to do this. Okay, who's high risk, who is low risk? There's many instruments out there. The most common one just sort of drops you into these buckets of low, intermediate, or high risk based on the PSA, which is the blood test. Okay, so PSA is okay as a screening test. It's not perfect, but it's actually a pretty good way of following people once they've got the cancer diagnosis. The Gleason score, that's how the cells look under the microscope, and the clinical stage. Can we feel it or not? Is it on both sides of the prostate, et cetera? And you can just kind of get dropped into one of these buckets depending on whether you have any of these risk factors. But it doesn't account for multiple factors. So somebody with a PSA 19, Gleason 4 plus 3, T2B is in the same category here as somebody who's got a PSA of 4, Gleason 3 plus 4, and a T1Cs, even though the second patient actually has much lower risk disease. So there's lots of ways out there of putting all these risk factors together. This is the CAPR score that we developed here, which just gives you points based on the PSA, the Gleason score, again, that's how the cells look under the microscope, whether there's any suggestion of the cancer outside the edge of the prostate on imaging, and how many of the biopsy cores are positive. We do a 12-core biopsy, do we find it in just one versus eight of the cores? And we can give a 0 to 10 risk score just based on adding up all these various points that can predict outcomes with pretty good accuracy. This is just looking at recurrence, so does the PSA ever come back after surgery? So you want to stay up here at the non-recurrent part of the graph. As time goes on here, each little step down is somebody who recurred. Their PSA came back after surgery. And the CAPR score can sort men in terms of their likelihood of recurrence with pretty good accuracy. It can be broken into three categories for low, intermediate, high risk. And it actually predicts not just recurring after surgery, but actually surviving prostate cancer. So this is likelihood of actually dying of prostate cancer, no matter what your treatment, within 10 to 12 years. You can predict that likelihood anywhere from 0 to about 25%. Now, we've been making a lot of progress specifically here at UCSF and other centers in the last few years in trying to do better than this. And this is pretty good. All right, the accuracy here is about 80%. So the bar is pretty high to try to improve on these risk predictions. So first of all, this brings up the point that anybody who tells you, like the task force will, that we can't tell the ones that need to be treated from the ones that don't need to be treated, simply, again, not true. They need to actually talk to an expert talk to somebody that knows how to take care of prostate cancer. We can very clearly tell which ones are aggressive and which ones are not, but we want to do better. So we've been very interested in looking for better biomarkers. And these are looking at tests in the blood, tests in the prostate cancer tissue, tests in the urine, that can give us a better readout on which prostate cancers are likely to become a problem versus not. And to a large extent, what we're looking at here are expression of genes. So, you know, every cell in your body is driven by genes. And what tells the cell it's a heart cell versus a brain cell versus a prostate cell, every cell in the body's got the same genes in it, the same DNA. And what tells the cell what it is which set of genes is turned on and which set of genes is turned off. And those genes are very tightly regulated. Every cell in the body's got its set pattern of on genes and off genes. And when those genes start to get turned on and off inappropriately, that is what leads to cancer. Okay? And we can start to find signatures of improper patterns of on and off, and that's called expression. Okay? So we can find some genes that are turned on when they're not supposed to be, some genes that are turned off when they're not supposed to be, and the more abnormal patterns we find, that tends to be the mark of a more aggressive cancer. There's a few of these things on the market now that are actually in clinical practice. One is the Prolaris test from a company called Myriad Genetics. They look at 31 genes all associated with cell cycle progression. This is how quickly the cells are dividing. So the faster the cells can grow, the faster the cancer grows. And that's regulated by this whole set of genes involved with what's called the cell cycle. Those genes are supposed to be tightly controlled. The cell is only supposed to divide when the old one is ready to die. The process needs to make a new cell. So if it's making cells faster than the old ones are dying off, that starts to cause cell growth and eventually can lead to cancer. And it turns out that if you look at a given level of clinical risk, this is the CABR score here, so low, intermediate, high risk by the usual criteria, the CCP scores, the Prolaris scores, really spread out here. So you can find cancers that look low risk and actually have low risk genetics, or you can find some that look low risk but have very aggressive looking genetics, and conversely, you can find some that are high risk but have low risk genetics, et cetera. And it turns out if we combine the two, if you put the clinical information together with the genetic information, we can predict recurrence after surgery ranging from virtually zero to nearly 100%. So this one's on the market now for looking at prostatectomy tissue, men that have had surgery, and for biopsy tissue. So men who've just been diagnosed on biopsy, trying to sort out whether or not they should get treated. There's a second one called the Oncotype Genomic Prostate Score. This is by a company called Genomic Health. They're best known for an Oncotype breast assay that's been out for a number of years for women with breast cancer. This looks at four different pathways, so different types of genes. Genes related to hormonal signaling, to how well the cells are structured and organized in the prostate, to proliferation. Again, this is kind of like the cell cycle. Stromal response, that's basically how the cells are responding next to their neighbors. And they put all these genes together. Again, some genes turned on, some genes turned off. And you get a score somewhere from 0 to 100. And they're able to get a signal out of tiny amounts of prostate cancer tissue now. And it turns out every 20-point increase in the score, even adjusting for everything that we already know about the cancer based on the usual factors, the PSA, how many cores positive, et cetera, you get about a doubling of risk. This odds ratio of 2 means about a doubling of risk for every 20-point increase in the score. And clinically, what we're able to do is really spread our risk predictions. So based on the CAPRA score, the old 0 to 10 score that I told you before, we can predict the true pathology. In other words, we can predict what would really happen if we took out the prostate with reasonable accuracy, like I told you before. So based on the CAPRA score, based on the baseline information, we could tell you somewhere between a 43 and 86% likelihood that if we took out your prostate, we're going to find a low-grade, organ-confined, low-risk, non-threatening cancer. Now, if you add the genetic information to that, you can actually spread these predictions out pretty substantially, both up and down in both directions. So for somebody who starts off with low-risk disease, we can give you a 90% or better prediction that it truly is low-risk. Or, you know, we can find a few of the cancers that look low-risk but actually have something fishy in the genes, something suspicious that predicts that this one might actually be a bad actor in the future. Conversely, there are some that look suspicious, high PSA, lots of cancer in the prostate, but they have a relatively indolent pattern in the genes. The genes are actually relatively turned off. And these are men who have what looks like intermediate risk disease, but actually probably can watch it for a while, can be on active surveillance safely. And about 50% of the men that we've looked at so far have at least a 5% shift up or down in this prediction. And we think it's helping us make better predictions about and better recommendations about who needs treatment at the time of diagnosis. I'm just going to breeze through the last one just in interest of time. The question really, though, is this really going to change practice? You know, I told you at the beginning, what we do now is we find prostate cancer and we treat it. You know, and we should be doing better just based on the CAPRA score. The state of the art really is not bad. We 80% accuracy in figuring out, you know, which prostate cancer should be treated and which shouldn't. And if we add biomarkers, you know, will that really be enough to fix it? And I'm not so sure that it's that simple. I think there's a number of other factors we need to think about: germline genetics, lifestyle factors, diet, environment, et cetera, comorbidity. You know, are you likely to die of a heart attack in the next 3 years? And to really prove that you can do a better job is much more complicated. We actually have a big DOD grant really aimed at proving that we can do better, because it's actually a complicated problem of both incomplete information. You know, we don't really know everything going on in the tumor, but also, you know, right now we have a man who's just been diagnosed with cancer. We throw a PSA, a Gleason score, a CAPRA score, all these numbers at him, and it's very difficult in some cases to really understand what's going on. And that combination of incomplete information and poor understanding of it leads to these big problems of overtreatment, of anxiety, of decisional regret, you know, saying a year later, I wish I hadn't had the surgery or the radiation, and avoidable cost and avoidable morbidity, in other words, side effects of treatment. So combining all the information just talked about is half the battle, you know, combining what we can learn about the tumor, about the patient, et cetera. Then the other half of it, though, is really packaging this in a form that even men with relatively low education can understand. And we have this whole decision support process of trying to package this information and making it make sense. And we think that these two together really will allow us to develop a decision support intervention that will improve decision making, improve satisfaction, improve active surveillance rates. Proving this is very difficult. It's building on a number of lines of research we've had at UCSF for a number of years, things like the CAPRA score, the genomic tests, what we know about the impact of smoking and things like that, decision support, as I mentioned, huge input as well from our patient advocate group here at UCSF. And our hope is that by 2016 to be able to really develop dashboards, something like this, that would combine the clinical information, the genetic information, lifestyle factors, et cetera, and really give you an overall picture of what this individual cancer is likely to do going forward. Now, as I mentioned, we're increasingly aware, I think, that active surveillance really is the preferred approach for low-risk prostate cancer. Now, active surveillance is not the same as watchful waiting. Watchful waiting was an older concept of, you know, you've got prostate cancer, but you're 83 with a bad heart. Don't worry about this. If you get symptoms later, we can put you on hormones and manage it that way. Surveillance is very different. The concept here is you're 50, you've got a low-risk prostate cancer. You may need treatment at some point in the future, but it does not need to be today. We probably have a window of opportunity that is measurable in decades in many cases, and you can safely defer therapy. We can watch this very carefully, and in most cases, intervene within a wide window of opportunity with every intent of cure. This has been increasingly recognized, I think, as a preferred approach for men with low-risk disease. There are now about 5,000 or 6,000 men actually reported from academic centers. Our experience here is up to about 1,200 men at UCSF that have gone down the active surveillance pathway. It's not entirely straightforward. You know, trying to figure out who is eligible, you know, and how we follow men is actually a topic of a lot of research. You know, PSA is not a perfect way of following men on active surveillance, so we still need to do periodic biopsies about every year. This is where we're really hoping these biomarkers will come into play, is not just figuring out who needs treatment, but figuring out better ways to do active surveillance. Can we avoid doing biopsies every year for men on surveillance? Can active surveillance be less active? You know, can we stratify some men to actually look to do something that looks more like watchful waiting? I'm going to gloss through the next couple things here. And part of what we're learning too is that some of these concepts that we thought we knew pretty clearly, like upgrading, you know, finding higher grade cancer on the biopsy is bad. Well, there's actually a lot of subtleties there. So if you have a Gleason 7 prostate cancer, that can be what's called a 3+4 or 4+3, meaning mostly low grade with a little bit of intermediate, or mostly intermediate with a little bit of low grade. That's the 3+4 versus the 4+3. How much intermediate is in there really turns out to be very critical. And there's a big difference between having just a speck of pattern 4 and having a prostate cancer which is almost half pattern 4. These things behave very differently biologically, but these men kind of all get dumped into the same risk category, and we tend to have this knee-jerk recommendation for treatment the minute we see any pattern 4. So we're really thinking in terms of loosening the criteria for surveillance and allowing more men to stay on surveillance who are still facing a very low likelihood of the cancer progressing. And we still know, though, that cancer anxiety is still a major driver of treatment. You know, it's not getting past the C word, getting past the diagnosis. And there are people out there that are starting to say we should just call this something else. Don't call it cancer when it's just three glands and one core out of 12. In bladder cancer, we have something called a papillary urothelial neoplasm of unclear malignant potential, which is a mouthful, but is accurate. You know, we're not calling it a cancer. We're calling it a neoplasm. You got to follow it, but you're not giving somebody the cancer diagnosis. There's another recommendation for an idle tumor, which is an indolent lesion of epithelial origin, which could apply to breast as well. My favorite one is the prostatic epithelial neoplasm of indeterminate significance, and you can mull on that one, because every man wants one of those. Which brings us really to how we should be treating this. And how this is a really, you know, an ongoing area of controversy. The Institute of Medicine put out this big report on comparative effectiveness research a couple years ago. Prostate cancer was in the top 25 conditions that they said we need more research trying to figure out the best way to treat this disease when it's newly diagnosed. What matters? Curing the cancer and then preserving quality of life. Urinary function, bowel function, sexual function are sort of the big three. But the important point to stress here again is that inappropriate care can never be high quality by definition. No matter how perfectly I do the surgery, put in the seeds, give the external beam radiation, if you didn't need the treatment, it was not a good quality treatment by definition. Now, we are getting some evidence more recently of, you know, of learning which treatments are most effective in which contexts. This is a large trial called PIVOT, which was run in the VA. This was coincidentally or not so coincidentally run by a guy called Tim Wilt, who actually ran the task force. Recommendation against screening. So the PIVOT trial tried to accrue 5,000 men to be randomized between surgery and watchful waiting within the VA. So they approached 13,000 men to find 5,000 who were eligible. They only got 700 to accept randomization. It's very hard, especially in the US, to get folks to accept that kind of a randomization. It's very hard. You know, you're going to flip a coin and get your prostate taken out or not. It's a difficult thing to sign up for. Although in other countries, they're much more successful about doing this in the setting of true ambivalence. Okay, if I tell you we really don't know whether the right thing is to take out the prostate or not, which is actually the truth, then, you know, randomization is actually ethical. It's still a hard sell in this country, but, you know, but from an ethical standpoint, I think it is important. And basically what they found, and again, the soundbite here when this paper came out, was that they did not find a statistically significant difference in favor of surgery over watchful waiting. These are the surgical patients here in red. Watchful waiting patients here in blue, the curves are pretty close. You're not much more likely to die whether or not you got surgery. But the vast majority of men that they got to accept the randomization had very low risk prostate cancer. So they weren't going to die no matter what they did. And in fact, the important finding from this study, which got buried in the supplemental online material and certainly did not get brought out in the New York Times article, is that if you look at low risk prostate cancer in this trial, these curves are completely superimposed. There is not a hint of a benefit for surgery for men with low-risk disease, at least up to 10 years. Now, there are caveats. This is the VA population who have a lot of other health problems on average. They're much more likely to die of something else during this 10 years of observation than the average person living out in a different healthcare system. But still, it's not like they didn't quite have enough numbers here. These curves are totally superimposed. But if you look at high-risk disease, they barely had, they had about 100 patients in this category, 150 patients, not nearly enough to do, you know, to have good statistical power, and yet they found statistically significant. You want to see this number less than 0.05, which it is. And these curves are diverging a lot and very early. A 60% mortality benefit for getting the treatment versus not getting the treatment if you have high-risk disease. So the take-home message here is not don't treat prostate cancer. It's don't treat low-risk prostate cancer. Absolutely treat high-risk prostate cancer aggressively. And to treat the high-risk prostate cancer, of course, you have to find it. Now, this slide summarizes the entire world literature on randomized trials of surgery versus radiation therapy, which, of course, there are none. The British have managed to do this. So the British did randomize between watchful waiting, surgery, and radiation therapy. We will have this trial out within the next couple of years. So in the meantime, we do have some retrospective studies, which are difficult to do. We did one of them in capture. The problem is that these patients are different. Men that undergo radiation therapy tend to have worse tumors than those that undergo surgery, for example. So you have to control very carefully for all these types of factors if you want to do a study in a cohort like capture, which is what I told you about before. It turns out we do see survival differences, though. This is a very recent update, which we haven't even published yet. This is looking at survival out to 15 years after surgery, watchful waiting and active surveillance. This is brachytherapy and radiation, and hormonal therapy. And first of all, what you see is that these curves are starting to really kind of step up beyond 12 years, which tells you, again, you need to follow men for a very, very long time to find out what happens to them because prostate cancer tends to move so slowly. But what really matters here is the adjusted analysis. So if we adjust for everything we know about the prostate cancer and the patient, so the PSA, the Gleason grade, the stage, how many cores positive, age, comorbidity, et cetera, the likelihood of dying of prostate cancer if you get external beam radiation therapy rather than the surgery is about twofold higher. And if you only get hormonal therapy, it's about threefold higher. And this is true whether we slice and dice the analysis in a lot of different ways. And this is sort of the bottom line how to interpret this, I think. For low-risk disease, this is not another one of the survival curves. These are just graphs showing you the likelihood of dying of prostate cancer within 15 years, depending on your risk and what your treatment is. So down here is low-risk disease, CAPRA zero, okay? Nobody dies of prostate cancer no matter what you do, all right? Whether you got surgery, radiation therapy, hormonal therapy, just watchful waiting, active surveillance, doesn't matter. There's really no difference between any of these treatment options. Everybody does about the same. But when you get into higher risk disease, you can see a real survival benefit, lower likelihood of mortality for surgery compared to radiation, compared to watchful waiting, compared to hormonal therapy. Now, this is exactly 180 flip from the treatment patterns that I showed you before, where men with low risk disease were most likely to get surgery, men with high risk disease were most likely to get hormonal therapy. So we need to really completely rethink the way we're managing men with prostate cancer. Folks at Memorial Sloan Kettering showed the exact same thing. Their curve is in the opposite direction because of the risk adjuster. This is low risk, this is high risk. Again, surgery versus radiation therapy. No difference for low risk disease. Big difference for high risk disease favoring surgery. In this case, it was 3-to-1 survival advantage favoring surgery over external beam radiation therapy. Just a couple more points. I think as far as quality of life, surgery versus radiation, there's really no controversy here. There's a lot of good literature on this. We know with no real argument, surgery causes more urinary incontinence, leakage of urine. Radiation causes more urinary irritative symptoms, which is feelings of having to go to the bathroom all the time to urinate or have a bowel movement or both. Radiation tends to cause more bowel symptoms. Both of them can impact erection function and sexual function. Surgery tends to be an earlier impact than radiation. And if you get hormonal therapy together with your radiation, that does have its own set of quality of life impacts. There's really nothing controversial about this, and nobody can say that it's better to leak than to have bowel problems. These are trade-offs that every individual interprets differently. You can hear a lot of controversy in the news about open versus robotic surgery. My favorite paper on this called it a great meaningless question in urology. We wrote an editorial here, really drawing the conclusion it's really not about the robot, it's about having somebody that knows how to use it. The analogy that I really like here is if you give Yo-Yo Ma's Stradivarius violin, he's going to sound better than on a dime store violin. If you give me a violin, you better clear the room because I have no idea how to play the violin. Okay? And if you take a mediocre surgeon and put him in front of the robot, it's not going to make him a good surgeon. It's not even going to make him a decent surgeon. Okay? You got to know how to do the surgery. If you know how to do the surgery well, I do believe this is a device that can, you know, that is associated with quicker recovery and probably better quality of life recovery in the right hands, but it really is about the right hands, not the technology. Similarly in radiation, you know, radiation is really now all about IMRT, largely for financial factors. We know radiation dose escalation does improve the PSA recurrence outcomes. You need to get hormonal therapy together with radiation if you have higher risk prostate cancer. Brachytherapy may be a little bit better than IMRT for some quality of life endpoints. These are sort of softer questions that get down into subtleties once you've got the diagnosis. But the last point I want to make is about cost, because this really is a significant public health problem. Prostate cancer is extremely common. It's about $10 billion a year in Medicare spending for prostate cancer. And what about the cost of all these technologies, you know, the robot, IMRT, et cetera? Well, it turns out the costs are borne differently. Hospitals actually absorb the costs for robots, whereas Medicare pays quite a bit for IMRT. And if you multiply this out, so the Medicare premium for robotic surgery on average in 2005 was $293 over open surgery. That's on a budget of about $25,000 to the hospital, not to the surgeon, but to the hospital. Whereas for IMRT, the premium is about $10,000 per patient. So you multiply this out times how often these things are done. So the total Medicare excess payment for robotic surgery in 2005 was about $4 million. Okay? For IMRT, it was about $350 million. Just by switching from old-style 3D conformal radiation to IMRT. There's no clinical reason for this. This is politics and accidents of history in terms of why certain things get funded in different ways by Medicare. There is no clinical rationale for it whatsoever. We built a complex cost-effectiveness model looking at all the things that could happen to you after surgery or radiation therapy. This is adjusted for secondary treatments, for quality of life impacts, et cetera, kind of following these, you know, modeling what could happen down all these different pathways and branch points. And it turns out that for low-risk prostate cancer, your quality here is a quality adjusted life year, how long you're likely to live and how well you're going to live in terms of side effects of treatment. There's really very little difference across the treatments for low risk disease. It is a little bit of dealer's choice. IMRT probably is not quite as good as brachytherapy or surgery, but there's a huge price premium for IMRT over these other treatments. We're paying a lot more and not getting better outcomes for it. You shouldn't even mention the word proton beam therapy in a cost effectiveness analysis. It's twice expensive again as IMRT and has never been shown in any paper to be any better than anything else. Now for high risk disease, it's a different story. Here you really need surgery or the combination of external beam and brachytherapy to get the maximum life years saved here, life years gained. But again, there's a higher cost for the radiation-based modalities. Just a comment on proton beam therapy, which is, you know, there's a center down in Loma Linda, and if you live near Loma Linda, just by happening to live there, you're fivefold more likely to get proton beam therapy just because of advertising and access and all this sort of thing. And we are building these proton centers all over the country. They cost $250 million to build, and everybody that puts one up is trying to drive, of course, their business in prostate cancer with no data whatsoever. And this, for me, is you know, something that Wall Street Journal editorial called this the death star of the American healthcare system, proton beam therapy. And it really is. You talk about low-hanging fruit for healthcare reform. Why we are paying $100,000 for a treatment that is no better in any way than a $25,000 treatment is absolutely beyond me. So I want to sum up with two quotes here. One is from that Dartmouth Atlas project that I mentioned way back when. They weren't talking specifically about prostate cancer, but they could have been. That there is unwarranted variation in the practice of medicine and the use of medical resources in the U.S. There is underuse of effective care, and here I would say that's surgery and radiation for high-risk disease. There is misuse of preference-sensitive care. In other words, treatments where just sort of what the patient chooses or what the doctor feels like recommending really drives care. And there's overuse of supply-sensitive care, meaning the more CT scanners you build, the more CAT scans get done. The more proton centers you build, the more proton therapy will get done. This is absolutely true. The other quote is from a gentleman named Will Whitmore, who was the former chair of urology at Memorial Sloan Kettering. Actually died of prostate cancer himself about 15 years ago. And he had a quote in the 1980s that could have been made yesterday and still been true. At the current state of prostate cancer may not be good medicine, but it sure is good business. And there's more people making a living from prostate cancer than there are dying from it. However, again, does this mean that the correct solution is to follow the task force and stop screening? And the answer is a resounding no. So this is a final slide from the CISNET group, the statistical modelers that I mentioned earlier. Their models here are in orange, okay? And the blue curve here is the actual observed data. So the point here is that they do a tremendously good job in modeling what actually happens, okay? So they can make predictions, you know, starting from early 1980s, 1990 data as to what will happen with the onset of PSA screening, and they actually predict what actually panned out in blue with remarkably good accuracy. This is the incidence curves here. Okay, so they predicted exactly how many excess prostate cancers we'd find, et cetera. They're also pretty good at predicting the mortality curves. Now, their prediction is a little bit less of a drop than what we observed. And this gets back to that first curve that I showed you at the beginning of the talk, that we can explain about a third of the mortality drop from screening, another third from improved treatment. And that and the rest of it, we don't really know. And that's the gap here between the orange and the blue. There probably are things like smoking cessation and things that explain the rest of it. But the sobering part of this graph is, you know, this is a thought experiment. What if we actually listened to the task force and just stopped screening for prostate cancer? Well, incidence will, of course, plummet because we will stop finding them. But as the population ages, and this population is going to age differently than every other one before, partly because of the baby boom and partly because men are living longer, that combination of factors is such that prostate cancer is going to rise anyway because we're going to have the largest population of men in their 80s and 90s in the country has ever seen. And what is a mathematical certainty is that by 2025, we will be back to where we were in the 1980s in terms of prostate cancer metastasis and mortality rates, and it will be much worse this time, partly because the numbers will be bigger and because the cost and the duration of taking care of a man with advanced prostate cancer in 2025 will be completely unaffordable for the healthcare system. So, you know, the idea that the correct answer is to put our heads in the sand and stop screening flies in the face of decades of research and, you know, reams of literature and, you know, cadres of experts, all of whom disagree vociferously with the task force. Unfortunately, they just sort of happen to have the stamp of the government. They're not better experts. They don't have better methodology. They are the only guideline panel that recommends against screening. Unfortunately, they're perceived as objective, so primary care docs tend to listen to them, and they've had a really negative influence here. The answer is we need to be doing this all better. Okay. The same guy that wrote the great meaningless questions in urology about open versus robotic surgery, another great editorial called, you know, PSA screening has been a disaster, let's keep doing it. And, you know, he brings up the point that we have not done this well. We screen men too late in life. We don't screen younger men. We screen older men with too many other health conditions who don't have a good life expectancy. We don't treat the right tumors appropriately. And we don't necessarily treat in high-volume centers, which do it well. But all of those are fixable problems. We need to be doing it better, not to just stop doing it. So, a few conclusions. First of all, again, please don't trust the New York Times headlines on complex healthcare issues. I think screening saves lives, period. There is really no argument among people that actually understand this literature that screening saves lives. You can argue about how many and what the harms are and all that sort of thing, but there's no argument that PSA-based screening saves lives. But screening needs to be done much better. Overdiagnosis has been a public health catastrophe in this country, but the solution is not just to turn us back to 1980. If we are better about risk adapting and risk targeting management of the disease, we can take care of the overdiagnosis problem without losing the tremendous grounds that we've gained in combating mortality from prostate cancer. These decisions really need to be driven by an individual man's health and disease risk characteristics, not necessarily by age. There's men who are 83 going on 60 and men who are 83 and they'll be lucky to make it to 83.2. And you have a very different decision for that person sitting in your office. The biomarkers and imaging and all these sorts of things coming down the pipeline may be of great benefit, but we don't necessarily need to wait for them, which is the other thing you frequently hear from those opposed to screening. So, you know, I think this is really not the right way to go. Is the approach of just kind of sticking our heads in the sand. The last point I want to make is that all this will be getting better soon. So the American Urologic Association is actually launching a true national registry, which is eventually going to be able to automatically capture data from electronic healthcare records on every man with urologic conditions in the country. And it's through efforts like this that we will really be able to understand better what is going on out there in the world in a big country with a big population, lots of urologists doing all kinds of different things. You know, tracking outcomes in different settings for different men with different practice patterns really will be even more important in the future than it has been in the last decade. So just want to thank the many, many people that have contributed to all the research here at UCSF in our department, both in the academic faculty, the statistical programmers, the ancillary faculty, and, you know, really wonderful support staff. Thanks all for your attention, and I've got time for questions. Yeah, well, busted. So, I mean, you know, the question is, what do you do with the data, right? So, you know, first of all, so I'm actually the physician lead on this effort by AUA, and we've been having these phone calls with urology practices all across the country. And of course, the first question is, what are you going to do with my data, right? Before a practice is going to be even remotely comfortable with turning on a system that will automatically report their data, you know, what are you going to do with my data? And the gist of it is, nobody's ever going to see anybody else's data. You'll be able to see your own practice pattern and your own outcomes benchmarked against the rest of the world, the rest of the country. They're already doing this in Michigan. So a friend of mine, Dave Miller at the University of Michigan, you know, Michigan is a unique place in that Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Michigan own the state. They cover 85% of all people living in Michigan have Blue Cross insurance. So that company, an insurance company, has a huge incentive to really, you know, put a lot of resources into trying to fix this. So they have put tens of millions of dollars into this really resource-intensive effort to build a registry in Michigan, and they feed back data to the practices. It's not punitive. They call this, you know, gentle shaming, right? So one of the quality metrics in prostate cancer is overusing bone scans. Okay, if you've got low-risk prostate cancer, you don't need to get a CAT scan or a bone scan because we know that those tests will be negative, and yet they're very frequently done. Okay, just again, not necessarily because the urologist owns the machine, he's gonna make money from it, because you just get used to checking the box or, you know, clicking the button on the EMR, but it's a huge waste of money and time and radiation exposure to the patients, et cetera. So they have just been feeding back the data to the individual urologists and saying, look, our statewide average is 10%. You're 40%. Not saying anything, you know, just saying, you know, just think about it. And, you know, it's not the data are not going to Blue Cross, nobody's denying payment, nobody's cutting into their income streams. But it's just sort of this feeding on the natural competitiveness of surgeons that nobody wants to be the outlier. They have also driven up their active surveillance rate to 50% in the state of Michigan, doing the same thing. You know, and it's not punitive. Nobody's carving in and saying, you know, you're providing terrible care. You know, it's just saying, look, you know, we know we should be doing a lot of surveillance for Leber's disease. Statewide average is 46%. You know, you're only at 10%. You know, you're not being punished, but you know, you should think about this. Talk to your partners and, you know, maybe reevaluate the way you're thinking about Leber's prostate cancer. And that's, things like that are incredibly effective. I think we are a long way away from putting anybody's detailed outcomes on the internet, but I think we might not be that far away from at least putting volumes there. You know, so you go to this practice, they did 100 prostatectomies, 30 brachytherapies, and 2 active surveillance last year. You know, this practice, it was 80 surveillance cases and, you know, 10 prostatectomies. You know, that sort of information, I think, is probably reasonable to put out there in the intermediate term. Not short term, but, well, you know, you need to make sure the data are correct.
Thank you.
Sure.
Please.
Yeah, I've had 3 biopsies and they're all low risk.
Yeah.
At what point do, you know, I really don't want to get another one.
Right, right.
What, I mean, I'm low risk, my mom would be 102.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
99.
Yeah.
And I, you know, if I know what I know now, I probably wouldn't have been tested in the first place.
Right.
So, So this is where the comment that I made, that we need to be doing active surveillance better. And we need to be, what I think actually, I think a lot of the promise for the biomarkers is not, you know, it, as we learn more about them, is not going to be really in figuring out who should be on surveillance versus treatment. But for men that are on surveillance, how can we do it, you know, in a more customized format, right? And the idea here, whether the and the biomarker, when I talk about biomarkers, I'm also talking about novel imaging tests. So when you hear about multiparametric MRI or these novel PET studies that are coming down the pipeline, they kind of play by the same rules in my mind in terms of what they need to prove, you know, in terms of the burden of proof that they can do a better job. Because I think the idea should be that you're diagnosed with low-risk prostate cancer, plus your biomarker says your genes are all behaving like they're supposed to be, come back in 4 years, we're not even going to think about this. 5 years, you know, think about this more like a colonoscopy kind of model, where we say, or you know, eventually get to the point where we say, you know, this looks low risk under the microscope, and the genes all look normal. Don't call it cancer. You know, that's the ultimate end game here. I think is a situation. You know, you've had 12 core biopsies 3 times. Each one showed one little speck, and this is not cancer the way we think about that word in this society. And, you know, that takes a big, I mean, there's a lot of institutional inertia. You got to get pathology, surgery, medicine. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, big organizations that need to agree to a change like that. But I think eventually that's the way we're going to head. For today, you know, at least active surveillance here at UCSF, we are stretching out the surveillance intervals longer and longer, and we're increasingly convinced that it's safe. Look, the challenge with this is that there is a day for everybody that's going to die of prostate cancer eventually. There's a day at which the first cell escapes, and we've missed the window, right? And we know that if you look nationally, the number of men who will die of prostate cancer because they went on surveillance instead of choosing immediate treatment is not zero. Mathematically, statistically, by definition, it's not zero. It's very, 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 very low. And it's probably far lower than the number of men that are harmed significantly by treatments that they did not need. But it's not zero. There are always going to be a small number of men whom we look back and wish we had just done treatment immediately. And I can think of, you know, we can, so of the 1,200, I have a couple hundred men on surveillance in my own practice, and I can think of 3 or 4 where we could really see the cancer change in a short interval, you know, behaving like the bird on that cartoon. And nobody is, you know, everybody's concerned about the sins of omission, right? You don't want to miss the window. So it's still a fairly conservative bent to the whole surveillance endeavor. But we're getting more and more comfortable with, first of all, putting more men on surveillance with more like intermediate risk cancers, and with doing the whole surveillance thing less intensively. And we've been primary drivers at this place at UCSF longer than just about anybody else around. So that's the way the field is heading.
Did you have confidence in the genomic health test? Do you have a lot of confidence in that?
Yeah, you know, it's early days. We did their big validation study. So, you know, that was a trial of 395 men aiming to predict the true pathology. And it was a positive study. It does add information to what we already knew based on the PSA Gleason score, et cetera. It's not perfect. Everybody wants a pregnancy test, right? You know, if it turns blue, take out the prostate. If it doesn't, you know, leave it in. It's never going to be that easy. These are all shades of gray. And it helps tell us this is a darker gray or a lighter gray. And at the end of the day, I can take 2 educated, well-informed men and tell them both you have a 3% risk that this will progress and kill you if we don't take it out now, right? And one guy may say, God, 3% is really high. take me to surgery tomorrow. The other guy may say, great, 3%, I'm gonna go play golf and, you know, come back for a biopsy in a year. Those are both good decisions, as long as they are well-educated, well-informed decisions. And that's where it's, I mean, there's still a lot of art in medicine when it comes to that, those sorts of decisions. The question is, how precisely can I tell you 3%? Right? You know, I can tell you with 80% accuracy today how these things behave. The biomarkers might push us to 90%, you know. Just pushing the accuracy is not enough. It really needs to be put in context. And none of these tests is perfect yet in that regard. You know, the companies are still working out how to present the information and that sort of thing. It's a good test, but it's not like it's solved all of our problems.
Yeah, please.
So how widespread is the use of these biomarker tests? Is this something that's brand new? And
yeah.
They are new. Oncotype hit the market last year. Prolaris, probably the year before, late 12, early 13. Prolaris was early 13. Oncotype late 13. The third one that I didn't spend much time on, which is more for men who have had surgery for high risk disease, called Decipher, that just hit the market earlier this year. So they're new. There have been several thousand tests run between the three companies nationally. So it's a small experience so far. I think they're marketing them very heavily, trying to get the word out. And you know, it's definitely not the case that everybody with a diagnosis should get one. I think it all sort of depends on the analogy is kind of the thermostat for the individual urologist. So a lot of urologists out there are not comfortable with the idea of surveillance for any prostate cancer. So in that setting, you know, they'll probably get the biomarker for men with low-risk disease, trying to sort out who they even think could start on surveillance in the first place. I'll tell you, in my practice here, if it's a low-volume 3+3 prostate cancer in one core, that's become a very short conversation for me. I tend to recommend surveillance for most men in that boat. So I'll usually use the tests for ones that I think are a little bit more on the edge. You know, it's higher volume 3+3, or there's a little bit of 3+4 in there, you know, Gleason 7. Ones that are a little bit more borderline for surveillance, or things don't look quite right, the PSA is higher than it should be, that sort of thing. That's where I'll use the markers and MRI as well. So, but that's going to be a little bit different in every urologist's practice, I think.
And are these tests widely available?
They're available. They're expensive, and nobody yet has Medicare approval for them. The companies all have varying degrees of patient assistance programs, and they all guarantee that you won't pay more than a couple $100 out of pocket. It's a little bit different from test to test, but you know they are expensive, and only a couple private insurers cover them so far. But any lab that they're essentially run, so it's not like the local hospital has to set up a lab to run it. They just have to send the actual glass pathology slides off to the central processing center.
Yeah, please.
The MRI looks at the entire prostate.
Yes.
And the lymph nodes.
Mm-hmm.
So in effect, because the advantage of being able to follow from year to year or from MRI to MRI.
Yes.
Do they detect changes the way they're supposed to?
That's a great question. The question, can we use MRI? Everybody wants to use MRI to replace biopsy, basically, in active surveillance. We're not there yet. We're getting there, but we're not there yet. First of all, MRI is extremely user-dependent. Okay, any radiologist can push start on the CAT scan and get a decent CAT scan of your kidneys. Okay, the prostate MRI really requires a lot of local institutional expertise just in how to even set up the scan itself. There's a lot of subtleties, and reading these things takes a lot of expertise. And we see reads that come in from the outside world that are just uninterpretable. And they still charge $6,000 to Medicare, which is what they cost, but it's totally uninterpretable. So MRI, first of all, I really believe at this point, really should only be done in high volume centers, just like the surgery should only be done in high volume centers, or at least centers of excellence. The other problem is that the issue with MRI, first of all, it tends to show a lot of little spots. And the issue is, well, what do you do with that? So we are actually, as of this coming Wednesday, I think, piloting a new system where we can actually fuse the MRI image onto the ultrasound at the time of the biopsy. So if there's anything abnormal on the MRI, we will be able to hit that directly with a needle and see if it is a cancer. Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. You know, MRI, even usually, so the way MRI works, you get this multiparametric sequence. So they look at the anatomy of the prostate, they look at the water density, which is called diffusion weighting, that's how densely the cells are packed. They look at something called dynamic contrast, which looks at the blood vessel density, because most cancers have more blood vessels in them than they should. That's how they get oxygen. And you kind of put all this very detailed information together, And then at the end of the day, the radiologist kind of looks at it and says, it's a 3, it's a 4. It's like this 1-5 scale. So there's a lot of subjectivity, actually, that goes into the read. And that's just the nature of the way it all works. But in theory, if they call it a 4 or a 5, that's supposed to be high-grade cancer, you know, guaranteed. And it's not always the case. You can put a needle right through the middle of that thing, and it comes back normal because imaging is not perfect. And it's also not perfect. It's very rare that MRI is going to miss a large high-grade cancer, but it might miss a small high-grade cancer. And that's what we worry about. Maybe we worry more than we should, right? And, you know, the number of men that we would miss if we switched tomorrow to MRI instead of biopsy would not be high, but all you need is for it to be a handful of guys that you have to look at and explain to them how we missed it. And, of course, people worry about lawsuits and all the other intangibles. Plus, MRI is a lot more expensive than a biopsy at this point, sadly. That's the other problem.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming.